Major funding for this program was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Funding for this program has been provided by the National Endowment for the Humanities, because democracy demands wisdom.
Additional funding was provided by the San Francisco Foundation.
Tierra, agua, libertad, justicia y ley.
From the moment it wins its independence from Spain in 1821, Mexico is buffeted by instability and war. In the Mexican-American War of 1848, it loses half of its land to the U.S. Then, two decades later, France invades and installs a monarch. Near the end of the 19th century, two decades of peace. But at the dawn of the 20th century, as political turmoil boils over in Russia, China, and elsewhere, Mexico erupts once again. This time, it's a deluge of violence that will claim nearly 2 million victims, a cataclysmic revolution that will change Mexico forever.
La revolución es un proceso social que tiene una relación íntima con toda la historia de México del siglo XIX. Vamos a encontrar nosotros que están presentes dos Méxicos.
México es un país muy grande y territorialmente, geográficamente, muy separado, las montañas de las planicies. Lo que sucedió en el norte de México, en el centro de México y en el sur de México puede contarse como historias hasta cierto punto comunes, pero sí con muchísimas diferencias.
The exploitation of Indians, the racism, the class differences, they have a huge impact on Mexico. And the revolution, which we're talking about now, was supposed to put a stop to this, but it didn't.
In 1876, reeling from nearly a century of conflict, Mexico elects Porfirio Díaz president. For more than 30 years, he will rule Mexico with an iron fist in what will become known as the Porfiriato. To some, he is the benevolent father, the peacemaker. But to others, the traitor, the man who gave Mexico away to the foreigners.
The Porfiriato is, in some ways, the beginning of that peculiar relationship between Mexico and the United States. The Porfiristas believed, given the economic thinking of that time, that the way to move ahead was to open the gates to foreign investment. Mexico was right next to the United States, so Mexico was largely an economic colony of the United States by 1900.
The center of power during the Porfiriato is Mexico City. Here, Villa surrounds himself by a group of technocrats known as the Científicos. This circle of power controls much of the nation's wealth, with little regard for anyone outside their circle.
The Científicos were the people who implemented his economic policies. These were the people who wrote the legislation for the passage of laws. These were the people who put together the contracts between the Mexican government and foreign companies and so on. They were elitist. Some of them were racist. That is, they believed in the notion that the biggest problem that Mexico faced was its backward Indian population.
Bueno, fundamentalmente durante el Porfiriato, la expresión artística siempre estuvo viendo, o sea, con los ojos, hacia Europa. Esto nos hace ver que siempre México, no obstante ser un país que se ha independizado, que está buscando su identidad, sigue con los ojos puestos siempre en Europa. Y en este caso, Porfirio Díaz está como muy claro de que para él México tiene que ser moderno, México tiene que ser un país de avanzada. Y por eso su lema de orden, paz y progreso. Ya está toda la industrialización y viene todo lo de la luz eléctrica y empieza todo lo de esta modernidad de las urbes. Por otra parte, tenemos a todo este pueblo indígena, este pueblo campesino, que está marginado, que no se le atiende, en donde se va a encontrar el descontento.
Porfirio Díaz was a strong ruler, and he held Mexico together with the help of the military of Hacendados and with American backing. The unrest was there because of the nature of that economy and the society of that time. Rural Mexico was poor. The Hacienda system was a tragedy for Mexico.
The haciendas were large estates. Some originated from Spanish land grants, while others were made up of lands the owners had bought or stolen. They were nearly totally self-sufficient enterprises that up until the revolution functioned in a semi-feudal system. The haciendas generated much of the wealth of the country, but most of it stayed in the hands of a few. The owner, called an hacendado, had nearly total power over the peones, the people who worked the land. The southern state of Morelos was home to some of the richest haciendas in all of Mexico. Many of them were sugar plantations, long known for horrendous conditions. After centuries of abuse, Morelos was ripe for a rebellion.
Un día en Cocoyoc, ahí en esa calle donde vivo, pues empujando a un español. ¡Indio, qué haces! Así con esa palabra orgullosa. ¿Qué haces, indio? El indio se agacha. Pues te lo ve, señor. Porque ya sabía que la opresión era grande. Por eso, los que nos lanzamos a la revolución en defensa de la patria, no fue una valentía, un orgullo, una necesidad. Que querían que trabajáramos a punta de cierranazos por 25 centavos, de la amaneciendo hasta metesol. Andaban los alcapataces en las calles, que no hubiera ninguno en su casa sentado ni acostado menos y lo veían, vamos para afuera, ni permiso pedían los alcapataces. A punta de chicotazo, vamos a cargarse la calle, a cortar calle, por 25 centavitos. Centavitos, no pesos, como ahora. ¿Y quién iba a aguantar eso? Dígame, ¿quién va a aguantar eso? Luego resultó esa la revolución.
In the north, the railroad means progress. But for the small landowners whose lands are taken over, progress means being left behind.
Pues van a producir muchos bandidos, van a producir muchos hombres libres que no están dispuestos a ser peones de hacienda. Y al momento en que se viene la revolución, muchos de los que se integran a los grupos revolucionarios son esos que fueron despojados o los hijos de esos que fueron despojados.
In the late Porfiriato, Americans had huge stakes in Mexico. The beginnings of petroleum, mining especially. The railroads were built by Americans. Many Americans owned land in Mexico. These were economic interests, and the Americans wanted to protect these interests.
American investments in Mexico were enormous in the early part of the 20th century. Some authorities say they were greater in value than all of the investments and property owned by Mexicans in Mexico.
While this close relationship with the U.S. benefits the científicos, Díaz is keenly aware that it places Mexico in a precarious and potentially dangerous position.
The Mexican government of Díaz was very much afraid of American influence. So wherever they could, they attempted to favor European interests.
In 1908, Howard Taft is elected the 27th president of the US. One of his main goals is to implement what he calls dollar diplomacy, his version of economic development in Latin America.
Unfortunately, the Howard Taft administration was incredibly ignorant of Latin America in general, and Mexico specifically in this case. His knowledge of Mexico came from his advisors who were interested in Mexico and in Latin America only for the purposes of generating profits for American companies.
Storm clouds begin to gather as a worldwide financial crisis causes skyrocketing interest rates. Farmers in northern Mexico go broke. Across the country, many are hungry. Among the hardest hit are the miners who often face intolerable working conditions. The abuse in the mines leads to strikes, and the strikes to violence.
The first of those strikes happened in northern Mexico in a copper mining town called Cananea, which is about 50 miles south of the Arizona border. The copper miners were both Mexican workers and US workers. And the strike broke out partly because Mexican workers wanted equal wages as the US counterparts, who were generally earning twice as much money. The thing that really grabbed the headlines in Mexico was the intervention of about 250 Arizona Rangers. There were about 20 to 30 workers killed during the strike. And this caused really major outrage in the rest of Mexico, because it implied that Porfirio Díaz couldn't control domestic affairs.
Strikes break out all over the country, at textile mills, tobacco factories, and railroad yards. In the cities, professionals complain they are being shut out from government jobs. There's discontent among landowners and businessmen as they watch the científicos prosper at their expense. Perhaps Díaz has been in charge long enough.
Si vemos al porfiriato desde el punto de vista del crecimiento y la afirmación de una economía mexicana, de una clase dirigente y una cultura, vamos a ver un espectáculo. Si lo vemos desde el punto de vista de la opresión de los indígenas, de los campesinos mexicanos, los trabajadores urbanos, en que esto se basaba, vamos a ver otra visión. Si combinamos las dos visiones, lo que nos va a aparecer en el medio es una gran injusticia. Esto es el porfiriato.
In 1908 comes a book, La Sucesión Presidencial, criticizes the 30-year Díaz dictatorship and calls for new elections. Its author, Francisco Madero, is virtually unknown outside of his home state of Coahuila.
He came from a very prominent wealthy family of hacendados and textile owners, mines and so on and so forth. He even studied briefly at the University of California at Berkeley.
Well, the attitude toward Francisco Madero by that small elite circle that surrounded Díaz was that he was basically a crackpot. He was referred to as the little crazy one, el loquito. So Francisco Madero just simply wasn't taken seriously. He was almost considered like a fly, an irritant, a gnat.
What does get the attention of President Díaz is a proclamation known as the Plan de San Luis Potosí. It calls for his removal.
Madero was not a radical. What he wanted was to have elections, free elections in Mexico, and he wanted to be president. And, you know, he met well, but he wasn't a man who was going to overturn the hacienda system. He wasn't a great friend of labor. He just happened to come on the scene at the right time.
Madero's call to revolution sparks numerous uprisings. In the northern states of Sonora and Chihuahua, ranchers and small businessmen had banded together to form anti-re-electionist clubs to depose Díaz. Now they take up arms. In the US, President Taft is caught off guard. These uprisings could easily threaten American interests.
Well, Taft, because he didn't know what the hell was going on in Mexico, didn't know what to do. So he basically did nothing directly, but allow his emissary in Mexico City, Henry Lane Wilson, a great deal of space to do what Henry Lane Wilson thought was in the American interest.
In Mexico City, Ambassador Wilson is the dean of the International Diplomatic Corps. Over the years, he and Díaz become allies. Díaz provides stability in a business-friendly environment. Wilson provides American financial and political support. But with Madero's declaration of war and the amassing of revolutionary troops in the North and South, there is concern in Mexico City and in Washington about how Díaz will weather this storm, which is quickly closing in on him on several fronts. The biggest threat now facing Díaz comes from the northern state of Chihuahua. where a rough-and-tumble outlaw turned revolutionary has put together an army to serve Madero and topple the Díaz regime.
¿Quién es Villa? Villa es un hombre que viene de la violencia social, de la violencia justificada, vamos a decirlo de esa manera.
In the early period of his life, he was an outlaw, not even a major outlaw. The idea that he was a major Robin Hood, taking from the rich, giving to the poor, before the revolution, is a legend.
Villa aprende rápidamente las técnicas militares de artillería, todo lo que tenga que ver con la ciencia militar. Y la otra cosa es que ante el pueblo, Villa es un hombre exactamente como cualquier campesino, como cualquier minero, como cualquier jornalero, como cualquier peón. Entonces, se le agrega todo esto, lo que él ha aprendido como jefe de bandoleros, a cómo tratar a la gente, y todo esto lo hace un gigante.
Francisco Villa is a man of contradictions who embodies the spirit of the northern border states of Sonora and Chihuahua. Bold, brash, with a flair for the dramatic, he never passes up an opportunity to be photographed. Down in the southern state of Morelos, a quieter, more calculating leader has captured the hearts and minds of the people.
Emiliano Zapata was probably the most dangerous figure for the moderates, for the liberals, for the reformers. He was dangerous because of his demand for land reform. It was a major threat to the whole notion of how power would be organized and had been organized in Mexico previously. So when Emiliano Zapata demanded the respect of these people, it was an incredible threat to that social order that took for granted the assumption that they had the right to rule, and that these indios, these descalzos, these peasants, the people who didn't wear shoes, the people that had no education and so on, had no right to have a place in Mexico.
Era un hombre de buen cuerpo, era un hombre muy noble, pero valiente. Eso sí. Cuando yo anduve con él, 2 años nada más, nosotros lo cuidábamos a él como él nos cuidaba a nosotros. Y ese era su pensamiento de él.
Emiliano Zapata literally carried around the ancestral claims to the land of his family and his followers in his town and in the area, the region from which he came. And these documents went back to the colonial period when Spanish authorities granted the indigenous people of that area those lands that were associated with Cuautla and those other towns in that area. It was this land that gave life to these communities. And that's what Zapata represented.
Villa and Zapata are from different regions, different worlds. But at their core, they have similar values.
In some respects, their visions were similar, in others, somewhat different. Both of them wanted a weak central government. They didn't want the central government to interfere with their areas. They were regionalists. Zapata thought in terms of Morelos and its surroundings, the state of Mexico, going as far as Puebla and Tlaxcala, while Villa thought in terms of the north, Chihuahua, Durango, Zacatecas.
Both want agrarian reform, but the visions for land reform are different. This has to do with the history of these regions and the sort of people who live there.
En Morelos es mucho más fuerte el peso de la sociedad indígena y la tradición de las comunidades indígenas. Entonces, hay una tradición mucho más comunitaria en comparación con la tradición más individualista que hay en el norte.
Madero's plan to overthrow Porfirio Díaz turns into full-scale warfare. In the spring of 1911, he takes on Díaz's federal army at Casas Grandes, Chihuahua. Then the campaign continues north to the border city of Juárez.
In 1911, when Madero was besieging Ciudad Juárez and victory seemed in the offing, Madero suddenly hesitated. Porfirian emissaries warned him, if you attack Ciudad Juárez, bullets might fly across the border into the United States, the Americans will intervene, so it's too dangerous. And he decided to retreat from Ciudad Juárez.
Madero's Revolutionary Army is under the command of two generals who are eager to fight, Francisco Villa and Pascual Orozco.
Against the orders of Madero, they attacked Ciudad Juárez. Madero finally had to agree, and the revolutionaries gained a major victory, and that changed the whole relationship of forces in Mexico.
In Mexico City, Villa cowers inside the presidential palace. Outside in the Zócalo, the central plaza, thousands clamor for his resignation. Madero spares Villa's life under the condition he'll go into exile.
Cuando con Porfirio finalmente se dio cuenta que había que retirarse porque era la única manera que vieron de tratar de contener lo que estaba sucediendo. Es frase famosa, verdadera o no, que haya dicho, Madero ha soltado un tigre, a ver cómo hace ahora para cabalgarlo. Pero es muy difícil cabalgar un tigre.
The military officer who was in charge of the military detachment that takes Díaz to Veracruz to get on the boat that would take him into exile was Victoriano Huerta. Huerta is an opportunist, a manipulator, is willing to use people, is willing to kill people in order to quench his thirst for power. So Madero entrusted Victoriano Huerta with that duty. And it was a sign of his willingness to use men like Huerta to, in a sense, trust them. That turned out to be a fatal flaw in Madero, of trusting the wrong people at the wrong time.
General Huerta accompanies Porfirio Díaz and his family to the port of Veracruz. From here, Díaz sails to France. He will live out the remainder of his days in Paris, an exiled man. In Mexico City, Madero marches in triumphantly. It seems that just about everyone is swept up in this new movement called Maderismo.
La revolución de 1910 en esta primera etapa es una revolución de personas formales, personas decentes. Entonces, el hecho de que un líder fuera reconocido en todas partes como bandolero le pesaba mucho a Madero, y prácticamente Madero hace a un lado a Villa.
In October 1911, Francisco Madero sweeps the presidential election. There is a sense of tranquility all across Mexico, but this period of peace will be short-lived. Almost from the beginning, Madero's grip on his presidency is weak. He has the support of Villa, but loses the backing of one of his early allies, General Pascual Orozco.
Madero quería que se reformara el sistema político sin una revolución. Y cuando la revolución triunfa, él pone límites muy claros. Él no quiere desmantelar todo el sistema.
Ambassador Henry Lane Wilson has little regard for Madero. He believes Madero is the wrong man to run Mexico. Wilson sees himself as the arbiter of U.S. policy in Mexico. So he begins his own campaign to undermine the Mexican president.
Wilson is there receiving the indications of the building coup, encouraging it, reporting very dire warnings to Washington. The country is in chaos, all our interests will be lost, the lives of Americans are in danger, despite the reports from the consuls, which indicated quite the opposite.
For Zapata, it's clear. With Madero, there is no future for agrarian reform. The entire region of Morelos starts to slip from Madero's grasp.
Zapata had revolted in the name of Madero, but Madero had never controlled him. And what Zapata wanted was an immediate land reform. Madero fought against him. He was, in the final account, an hacendado. He was not willing to agree to any expropriation of people from his own class.
Y entonces rompe el movimiento campesino con Madero. El gobierno maderista da la orden de luchar por desarmar a los zapatistas, y fue una lucha muy cruenta.
Zapata promulga el Plan de Ayala el 6 de noviembre de 1911, levantándose en armas contra Madero, nombrando al jefe de esa revolución a Pascual Orozco.
Emiliano Zapata and Pascual Orozco join forces, posing a serious threat to Madero. Orozco had been Madero's ally in the beginning, but was pushed aside because the general had defied the president at the Battle of Juarez. But the way Madero handles Orozco will come to cost the president more than he could ever imagine.
When there's the break between Madero and Orozco, Madero turns to Huerta to lead the federal troops against Orozco, somewhat reluctantly, because Huerta had a reputation already. He was a thug, he was a drunkard, he was corrupt. Huerta then goes after Orozco with complete impunity when it came to squashing the Orozco rebellion, because he saw this was the opportunity for Madero to be beholden to him, Victoriano Huerta.
Ambassador Wilson supports Huerta, but in Washington, there is little respect for the general. He's too unpredictable and ruthless. So the Taft administration begins to look for options in the event that Madero is ousted. Although Orozco is considered a hero by Mexicans, he has declared himself to be anti-American. But in the northern states of Chihuahua and Durango, popular support for Villa keeps growing.
Y en la medida en que el liderazgo de Villa va creciendo, Estados Unidos lo apoya, porque además Villa demuestra una simpatía muy grande por los norteamericanos. O sea, de 1913 a 1914, Villa no tiene más de que halagos para los norteamericanos. Entonces, saben del poder que tiene con el pueblo. Y mientras ese poder lo pueden controlar, dejan que se desarrolle.
General Villa chooses to play it smart. He doesn't take sides. This way, he gets what he wants: U.S. support and American weapons. In the summer of 1912, Madero attempts to gain favor with the Zapatistas by taking a new approach. He tries to work out concessions, but the military leaders in Mexico City, including Huerta, accuse him of undermining their war with Zapata.
Huerta considered himself a self-made man, but he was the son of a mestizo and a Huichol Indian woman. This was a man, under any other circumstances, would be among the poor of Mexico during the Porfiriato. And I think Huerta had a streak of self-hate. He was ashamed of his past. And that shame led to a desire to do away with those people who reminded him of who he had been, of who he no longer wanted to be. And I think, to some extent, that self-hate reflected itself in the ways in which he was so vicious in his military campaign against the Zapatistas.
Huerta was a typical caudillo, the man on horseback in Latin American politics, and Henry Lane Wilson saw him as superior to Madero.
Ambassador Wilson keeps up the pressure. He argues that by removing Madero, U.S. interests will be protected. The ambassador grows even closer to Huerta, and the plot to eliminate Madero takes shape.
Y en 1913, el embajador norteamericano juega un papel determinante en el golpe de Estado de Victoriano Huerta.
The warning came very clearly to Wilson from Huerta that they were going to make a move against Madero. And so you have a kind of shadow play. Wilson is taking his initiatives, but he has inside information.
In February 1913, Mexico City is engulfed in a flood of violence. It's a war zone. Known as the 10 Tragic Days, this horrendous battle, begun as a mutiny, is orchestrated by Huerta to destabilize the Madero government. Behind the scenes, Ambassador Wilson continues to support Huerta.
A principios de 1913, las condiciones están ya perfectamente dadas para que Victoriano Huerta, junto con un grupo de militares porfiristas, decida ejecutar al presidente Francisco I. Madero y al vicepresidente José María Pino Suárez.
On February 18th, President Madero and Vice President Pino Suárez are arrested in a coup arranged by Huerta with the blessing of Ambassador Wilson. Madero's wife goes to Wilson and begs him to intervene and save her husband's life. He tells her, "Your husband's downfall is due to the fact that he never wanted to consult with me." Huerta's men tip off the prison guards that there may be an attempted prison break by dangerous criminals. On the night of February 22nd, just outside the walls of the Lucumberri prison, Madero and Pino Suarez are assassinated. Huerta becomes president of Mexico.
Villa felt that he would avenge Madero's death and that he would continue the revolution that Madero started, though in a very different way from what Madero would have done.
The news of Madero's assassination sends tremors across the country, releasing waves of hatred towards Huerta.
Cuando es asesinado Madero, lo que hace Victoriano Huerta es destapar los reclamos del pueblo, que ya no son el respeto al voto y estas cuestiones, sino que ya es el reclamo por todos los años de dictadura, por todo el cúmulo de injusticias que se habían forjado durante 30 años de dictadura.
With Madero out of the way, Ambassador Wilson has his wish. But he has a new problem. In Washington, Huerta's ruthless coup has created a crisis of confidence, and the ambassador's influence begins to slip. On March 4th, 1913, Woodrow Wilson becomes president of the United States. He summons Henry Lane Wilson to Washington and dismisses him as ambassador to Mexico. The Wilson administration refuses to accept Huerta's regime and begins to shift its support to the new alliance of revolutionary generals Carranza, Obregón, and Francisco Villa.
Francisco Villa logra reunir un contingente numeroso y gracias a sus éxitos, gracias a su liderazgo, todos los demás jefes van a terminar nombrándolo a él el líder de todas las fuerzas que habían surgido aquí en Chihuahua. Villa destaca muy pronto entre todos los jefes militares que surgen después de del golpe de Estado militar de Victoriano Huerta y se convierte en jefe de la División del Norte y logra muchos triunfos. Pero aquí hay un factor que se tiene que tener muy presente. Villa era un jugador, le gustaba el azar. Muchas de sus grandes proezas no fueron fruto del cálculo meticuloso, seguro. Muchas acciones de Villa eran azarosas.
Villa's survival skills, instincts, and luck have served him well in life and on the battlefield. But now a more complex, enigmatic Villa begins to emerge. His tactics on and off the battlefield are sometimes spectacular. Yet some of his most important innovations are practical, like his extensive use of the railroad.
For the Villistas, the railroads were decisive because they allowed the soldiers to rapidly go from one area to another. The soldiers would sit on the roof, the horses in the cars, and it gave the Villa army a tremendous mobility. It also gave Villa a unique opportunity to care for his soldiers. All his trains were followed by hospital trains. And also, it allowed Villa to do something that Zapata had less interest in, namely take the families of the soldiers along. In the trains, the soldaderas, the women, fulfilled a very useful function. They foraged for food, cooked, tended frequently to the wounded, and many of these women fought as well.
Valentina, Valentina, yo te quisiera decir.
Las mujeres iban arriba en el techo con los hombres mojándose. Yo creo que sin las soldaderas, sin las mujeres en la Revolución Mexicana, simplemente no hay revolución, porque los soldados se hubieran desertado, hubieran regresado a su casa a dormir en su cama con su mujer.
Que me maten de una vez.
When in 1913, Villa captured Chihuahua and became governor of the state, he was able to administer one of the most advanced economic states of Mexico. And he gained the respect of the United States by being able to afford protection to all American enterprises.
General Villa, widely known by his nickname Pancho, has become an international celebrity. He's pursued by Hollywood and signs a contract with a mutual film company to film some of his major battles.
Villa empieza a adquirir dimensiones míticas. En este momento, las mismas tropas de Villa empiezan a exaltar y a celebrar sus triunfos en el campo de batalla, empiezan a generar historias populares, empiezan a componer corridos que exaltan a Villa y, por extensión, a ellos mismos, que son partícipes de esta épica popular.
Yo soy soldado de Pancho Villa. De sus dorados soy el más fiel.
La manera como se representa o se habla de Villa en los periódicos norteamericanos es muy ambivalente. Por un lado, se le reconocen sus virtudes como militar, pero por el otro lado, se le describe como un hombre primitivo, como un hombre de tendencias animalescas que se guía por instintos primitivos.
As Villa's popularity grows in Mexico and the US, Huerta's image withers. Washington senses that Huerta is about to betray the US.
In 1914, they heard that a German ship carrying arms for Huerta was to land in Veracruz. To prevent these arms from reaching Huerta, the United States decided to invade Veracruz.
On April 21st, 1914, warships of the U.S. Atlantic Fleet sail into the Mexican port of Veracruz. 3,000 U.S. Marines invade the city, overwhelming the Mexican forces. In the days that follow, hundreds of men, women, and children are killed in the crossfire. It will be 7 months before the U.S. Navy pulls out of Veracruz. In the short term, Huerta's popularity rises as he is able to rally broad national support against yet another invasion by the Americans. In central Mexico, Huerta faces his old revolutionary foe, General Villa. His federal army is devastated at the battles of Torreon and Zacatecas. Huerta is surrounded by enemies. Fearing for his life, he flees and boards a German ship bound for Spain. It is now July 1914, just weeks before World War I breaks out in Europe.
Cuando cae Huerta, hay varias facciones revolucionarias. Se reúne la Convención de Aguascalientes en octubre del 14 con representantes obregonistas de Carranza, con representantes del ejército villista.
The revolutionary forces have now split into two factions. One, known as the Constitutionalists, is headed by Carranza and Obregón, the other by Villa and Zapata.
What you have in Aguascalientes is the different factions that had toppled Huerta. come together in order to try to reach some kind of accord as to what's going to happen next. And what you have very clearly are competing views as to where Mexico needs to go next. And even though there are attempts at trying to reconcile these different views, in the end, that reconciliation doesn't take place.
Zapata refuses to attend the convention at Aguascalientes because he distrusts Carranza and the constitutionalists. They have never supported his demand for agrarian reform. So Villa reaches out to him. The two agree to meet in Xochimilco, the village of the floating gardens. They are just a few miles from Zapata's home state of Morelos.
What they did was to ratify their alliance and to divide the military command. The Zapatistas would operate in the south, the Villistas in the north.
After their meeting in Xochimilco, the united armies of Zapata and Villa march into Mexico City. This is an army of the people, unlike any the residents of Mexico City have ever seen.
When Villa's army entered Mexico City, they all had uniforms. They all had the same kind of rifles. It was the impression of an army coming into Mexico City. The Zapatistas had huaraches, the peasant shirts, armed with an array of rifles, muskets, machetes. They simply didn't have the resources that Villa had. On the other hand, the Zapatistas were the most respectful of private property. They knocked at doors, asking if they had a few tortillas to give them, while the Villistas took what they wanted.
During the winter of 1914, Villa and Zapata control Mexico City. Not wanting to confront them, Carranza sets up his constitutionalist headquarters in Veracruz. But neither Villa nor Zapata have the experience nor the will to run Mexico.
They wish not to directly participate in the national government. If Villa had wanted at the time, he could have been president. But he had no interest in becoming president of Mexico and returned to the north as soon as possible, and Zapata returned even more quickly to Morelos. They despised the city of Mexico.
By and large, the constitutionalists and Carranza were reformers at best, people who believed that the political order of Porfirio Díaz needed to be replaced by people like themselves, but not necessarily do away with that political pyramid that had been constructed during the Porfiriato. Carranza was of those people. Carranza was the kind of man that only wanted political change at best. These men had no interest in advancing the cause of landless peasants, advancing the cause of working class people. They were interested in advancing their own careers and aspirations.
Once again, Mexico is at war. But this is a civil war. On one side are the constitutionalists. On the other, Villa and Zapata. The battles of Celaya and Agua Prieta are among the first of several defeats for General Villa. Villa continues to employ traditional infantry warfare, while Álvaro Obregón, Carranza's general, adopts new advanced techniques being used in Europe, barbed wire and trench warfare.
Ya en ese momento se han acumulado una serie de factores negativos sobre Villa, y aquí es donde viene el gran momento, ¿verdad?, en que Estados Unidos tiene que resolver a quién reconoce.
By now, World War I is raging in Europe, and the U.S. is on the verge of being drawn into the vortex. President Wilson must decide how to handle the situation in Mexico.
There were several factors that led the Wilson administration to turn against Villa. One of the most important was the fact that Villa had been defeated. He had lost the Battle of Celaya, and World War I had broken out in Europe. What the Americans wanted was a quiet and stable Mexico. Since Carranza had won, they would support him.
Villa is outraged at his betrayal by the U.S. He lashes out and attacks the small town of Columbus, New Mexico, where 17 Americans and more than 100 of Villa's men are killed.
Después de la invasión de Columbus por las tropas villistas en 1916, se refuerza el mito negativo de Villa, el Villa salvaje, impulsivo, criminal, ¿verdad?, en la prensa de Estados Unidos. Pero del lado mexicano, curiosamente, sucede lo opuesto. La invasión de Columbus es visto como un acto de reafirmación nacionalista del pueblo de México ante, ¿verdad?, un vecino que suele humillar y explotar, ¿verdad?, a los inmigrantes mexicanos.
Villa's raid on Columbus, New Mexico, puts President Carranza in a tough spot. He wants Villa out of the way, but he cannot appear to appease the Americans. But in March 1916, he allows a U.S. expedition led by General John J. Pershing into Mexican territory to pursue Villa. Pershing's troops search for Villa well into 1917, but they never find him. Villa is betrayed by the U.S. and then cornered by his own president when Carranza backs out on a deal to allow him safe passage to Cuba.
Eso va a determinar que Villa actúe como fiera acorralada ya, ¿verdad? Y empieza a armar su movimiento guerrillero durante 17, 18, 19. Entonces, vuelve a crecer y a tomar ciudades. Vuelve a tomar Ciudad Juárez, vuelve a tomar Parral, vuelve a tomar varias poblaciones importantes aquí en el estado.
People were afraid of his military capacity. And having that presence within Mexico at that time was like putting a knife to the throat of the constitutionalists. And they had to remove that knife because Villa, on more than one occasion, not only had put that knife to their throat, but had raised it, in a manner of speaking. And they had to get rid of it.
In Europe, the World War entered its second year. In the United States, the public is deeply divided about whether or not to join the fight against Germany. And in Mexico, President Venustiano Carranza finds himself in a tough spot. Both Germany and the United States have their eye on Mexican oil, a necessity for fighting a war. in dire need of political legitimacy, but suspicious that the U.S. might once again intervene in Mexico's affairs. He takes a dangerous risk. He provides Germany with oil and asks them for help.
Sometime in late 1916, Carranza sent a letter to Germany asking the Germans to supply him with arms, asking the Germans to give him U-boats, and pleading for German help.
From Berlin, German Foreign Secretary Arthur Zimmermann replies to Carranza with a proposition in the form of a coded telegram.
At this point, Foreign Secretary Zimmermann decided, since he had received this call for help from Carranza, to use that for his own purposes. He sent an offer to Carranza, telling him that in case a war broke out, if Carranza were to align himself with Germany and attack the United States, then Germany would have no objection to having Mexico regain Arizona, Texas, and New Mexico. What the Germans did not know was that the British had intercepted their code. This was one of the highlights of all of espionage history.
When the British government discovered this correspondence, it was dynamite. It could be used at the right moment by the British government to push the United States into war against Germany.
The British make certain the Germans don't discover that their code has been broken. They reroute the telegram through Mexico City, making it seem as if the leak had come from the German embassy there.
They then delivered the Zimmermann telegram to the Americans, and it was published in the newspapers.
It was a shocker. It was stunning. It was the very kind of thing that the Monroe Doctrine had been designed to prevent, that is, the intervention of European powers in the Western Hemisphere, in the American sphere of influence. Here was Germany playing a balance of power game with the Mexican government, and the Mexican government agreed. It was very alarming to the people in Washington and had a clear impact on Wilson's thinking about the decision to go to war.
Wilson's support for entering World War I had always been strong on the East Coast, but not in the Southwest, which was isolationist. But once Texas, Arizona, and New Mexico had been promised to Mexico, that isolationism broke, and it helped Wilson's efforts to mobilize public opinion against Germany.
And that decision to take the United States into war in Europe relieved pressure on Mexican-U.S. relationship enormously. The United States really was swallowed up in the European campaign.
Carranza abandons any aspirations of collaborating with Germany. Instead, he focuses on domestic issues. For the time being, General Villa has been marginalized, and his occasional fighting is restricted to Chihuahua. Carranza now turns his attention to a larger goal, a new constitution for Mexico. He calls for a constitutional convention. But instead of the moderate reforms he envisions, the Constitution, as ratified, provides unprecedented rights for its poor and working classes.
There are a number of provisions which directly address the concerns of workers as far as the right to strike, the right to organize, the setting of limits on the length of the workday, and so on.
But the most important provision deals with the land. Article 27 guarantees that only Mexico and its citizens own the natural resources above and below the ground. The Constitution also promises agrarian reform, much as Zapata had envisioned.
La Constitución fue como un mapa del país que queríamos. Ahora, que ese, bueno, como en todo el mundo, que ese mapa se haya puesto en práctica tal como se preveía, pues no, no se puso en práctica.
Carranza's dismissal of the promises of the new constitution is seen by Zapata as yet another betrayal by the powers in Mexico City. He accelerates his campaign against the federal troops, engaging in skirmishes and destroying railroad lines just outside Mexico City.
We have to understand that right next door is the bastion of the strength of Emiliano Zapata, and that's the state of Morelos. And Carranza was fearful that Zapata was too close. He needed to squash him. He needed to eliminate that threat.
Zapata's soldiers were from backgrounds like his. Many had been with him for years, and they were totally devoted to him.
Todo nos hizo valer Zapata para darle a la gente, a los pobres, para que comieran. Allí en la tranca, formaba la gente, a los pobres, les empezaba a dar el comestible, desde azúcar, arroz, bueno, cosas de comer. Pero él cumplía con darles a cada quien lo suyo. Así fue la cosa, que convivió con los pobres. Él apreció a los pobres como, ¿cómo le diría a usted? Otro como Zapata, ya no se lo haya Morelos.
General Pablo González was given the responsibility by Carranza to basically bring Zapata in, dead or alive. So González hatched a plot in which one of his military officers, by the name of Guajardo, would pretend to want to defect to the Zapatista side. And they were so ruthless, Guajardo ambushes federal troops. Scores of federal troops are killed in this performance to convince Zapata that, in fact, Guajardo is sincere in his desire to defect. And so a meeting is set up in which Zapata is to go to this hacienda to sign the accord that would bring Guajardo into the Zapatista camp.
Entonces, le manda decir Guajardo Zapata que quería hablar con él, que lo invitaba a comer allí en Chinameca, en la hacienda de Chinameca.
On that day, he takes only a handful of his most trusted lieutenants. And there was a man playing the trumpet. This was allegedly a salute upon Zapata's entry into the hacienda. And when he actually came into the courtyard of the hacienda, when the gates opened, the men who were allegedly going to give him a gun salute trained their rifles on Zapata.
No está mirando. Allá está la hacienda abajo. Cuando yo el descargue. Cuando los balazos, el caballero regresó, llegó con nosotros. Vimos el caballero bañado en sangre. Todo llorando. No está vergüenza en eso. Nos habíamos bajado.
And they knew that El General had been assassinated by Guajardo's men.
Sentimos que ya se había acabado pues el hombre que iba a defender a la unidad mexicana, si no se separaba por esa cosa, más de que Zapata. Ya lo habían matado, ¿qué cosa? ¿Qué haría usted? Nada, ¿verdad? ¿Ah? Así fue la cosa.
¿Qué sentimos? Una cosa triste. Para todos los que nos tocó la muerte. Una tristeza. Casi que fue nuestro padre que nos quitó el yugo de la frente.
That he was assassinated by the forces of Carranza seemed almost inevitable. He died an honorable, honest man. And that is why Zapata is still looked upon as a kind of hero by so many Mexicanos.
Carranza's assassination of Zapata triggers a series of events that will determine his own fate.
Every president realizes that he must be able to put this metaphor, this tiger, into its cage, or it has the potential of literally devouring his presidency and perhaps even killing him.
Los zapatistas que continúan peleando se alían con Álvaro Obregón para derrocar en 1920 al entonces presidente Carranza, Venustiano Carranza.
Sensing his own vulnerability, Carranza attempts to escape to Veracruz by train. He takes with him all the assets of his administration, but the so-called golden train is sabotaged en route. Carranza is assassinated that night. With Carranza safely out of the way, Álvaro Obregón campaigns for the presidency, and he wins. He is inaugurated in 1920, promising to leave behind the decade of violence and to begin to rebuild Mexico.
What happens, in effect, is leader after leader makes concessions in the hopes of taming this tiger, of taming those forces that continue to demand not just reforms, not just moderate change, but deep, social, radical change.
When Carranza fell and Obregón took power, the main aim of Obregón was to reestablish a Mexican state. At the same time, many of the revolutionary generals had become warlords, dominating their own armies. That was one enormous problem.
In 1923, Villa appears to be living the life of a rancher near Parral, Chihuahua. He surrounds himself with the soldiers he once commanded. Now they're both friends and bodyguards. But in early summer, a plot is hatched among the powerful friends of Obregón, many of whom already hold grudges against Villa.
En 1923 se empieza a buscar personajes que se habían distinguido por tener afrentas contra Villa, algunos incluso que habían sido en algún momento compañeros de Villa. Suceden varias cosas que no podían haber sucedido si no hubiera una maquinación ya oficial. Y una de ellas es de que el cuerpo militar que está en Parral, el grupo militar, se retira de la ciudad. De manera que los ejecutores actúan prácticamente en la libre.
On a hot July afternoon, Villa and his bodyguards are driving to his ranch in Canutillo, just a few miles outside the city of Parral. As they drive down a main street, a sudden hail of bullets from the side of the road rains down on the car, leaving Villa and three of his men dead.
Entonces, el mismo gobierno mantuvo un silencio casi de castigo, ¿verdad?, para que no se hablara de Villa, para que no se dieran a conocer de manera positiva sus acciones de liderazgo, y queda fuera de la historia, ¿verdad?
Both Álvaro Obregón and his successor to the presidency, Plutarco Elías Calles, had fought against Francisco Villa. Now they see an opportunity to eliminate him from the official pantheon of revolutionary heroes. When Calles becomes president in 1924, he implements a national educational initiative which reaches even the illiterate poor in the rural areas. He also begins to institute agrarian and labor reform, but only to the extent necessary to keep the peace.
Calles was a political operator. He was manipulative, he was opportunistic. And much of what he did on the progressive side was a calculated move to make strategic concessions to the possibility of political rivalries or political dissidents. And in this respect, for example, his distribution of land had a lot to do with an attempt to continue to tame the tiger regarding agrarian reform. His so-called reforms of labor were, to a large extent, to try to sustain the support of unions.
It seems that for the first time, the Mexican workers will have national unions that will represent them. The largest is the CROM, the Regional Confederation of Mexican Workers.
The CROM gave the state some important muscle, some political and economic muscle. They also gave the ability to present themselves as the inheritors of the social and economic ideals of the Mexican Revolution.
The CROM thrives under the leadership of its charismatic leader, Luis Napoleón Morones. But in 1925, it seems to change direction. Morones accepts an appointment from President Calles as the Minister of Commerce and Industry.
One of the negative features that was already visible in the CROM in the 1920s is the beginnings of the development of a corrupt group of labor bosses or labor czars, of whom Luis Morones was one of the most fascinating examples, who begin to see their role as being more to deliver workers for the state than to use the state to bring benefits to their labor force.
El periodo callista es interesante porque refleja precisamente todas las contradicciones que se están viviendo en este momento. Calles, efectivamente, adopta posturas cada vez más y más conservadoras, especialmente en materia agraria, porque le parece que son improcedentes, improductivas para el desarrollo de México.
In 1928, Calles' term ends. Álvaro Obregón is re-elected to the presidency. But before his inauguration takes place, at a banquet held in his honor, Obregón is murdered. The violence on the battlefield may have ended in 1920, but not the bloodshed. In less than a decade, Presidents Carranza and Obregón are assassinated, as well as revolutionary generals Villa and Zapata. The presidency is in limbo. Gaius wants to step in, but by law, he cannot serve another consecutive term as president. So he engineers the rise to power of a series of puppet presidents.
Between 1928 and 1934, what you have is the Maximato, a process in which Gaius puts together a political coalition that would remain loyal to Gaius and his control over the politics of Mexico. Gaius was known as the Jefe Máximo, the supreme chief. By 1934, the full impact of the World Depression has hit Mexico. There is increasing discontent. It is palpable. People can feel it. People can see it.
Tens of thousands of Mexican workers who had left Mexico in the preceding 20 years to work in the U.S. make their way back to Mexico. They're unemployed. They exacerbate the crisis already being experienced in Mexico.
The Maximato presidents, still under the control of ex-president Calles, resist any significant land or labor reform. Now, with the Depression, unemployment skyrockets. Another storm looms on the horizon.
So this political cabal realizes that there has to be some degree of recognition of this growing restiveness and discontent and anger over what is taking place in Mexico, given the impact of the Depression.
So the stage is being set in 1932, 33, and 34 for the arrival of a brand new and very importantly different phase in the history of the Mexican Revolution, the period of Lázaro Cárdenas.
Calles thought, here's a military leader who has always been very loyal to me. He thought of as a kind of moderate who, when he was governor of Michoacán, had helped peasants but had not been a radical. And Cárdenas became the candidate of the PNR, the Partido Nacional Revolucionario.
Mi padre fue a hablar con el general Calles, a quien consideraba, por otro lado, su jefe político. Y entre las muchas cosas que le trató, le dijo que quería primero su autorización para presentar su candidatura. El general Calles lo escuchó y le dijo que no se preocupara, que él podía con toda confianza aceptar la candidatura a la presidencia.
In 1934, Lázaro Cárdenas runs for president. He wins by a landslide, and Mexico celebrates.
Cárdenas stitches together an alliance of key military leaders, key civil leaders, and begins to make himself independent of the Jefe Máximo.
Himself of humble Indian stock, Cárdenas was determined when he took office in late 1934 to give the people of Mexico a new and better deal.
President Cárdenas begins to implement some of the meaningful changes that had been promised by the 1917 Constitution. Changes that the presidents before him had failed to make.
So Gaius is getting phone calls. What the hell is going on? This guy really thinks he's president. He really believes that he can do all these things that you said he wouldn't do. So businessmen are calling him because workers are striking. Landowners are calling him about peasants taking over land that was theirs. People are demanding higher wages. So the Jefe Máximo says, okay, I'll go and show him his boss. He starts making phone calls to his ex-generals, his businessmen friends, putting together the possibility of removing Cárdenas from office as the Jefe Máximo had done in the past three times.
But this time, it's the new president who turns the tables on Calles.
He's in bed, And a military officer walks into his bedroom and he says, "You are under arrest and you are to come with me." He takes him to the airfield, puts him on a plane, and says, "Don't come back, because it would be very bad for your health." So on April the 16th, 1936, Plutarco Elias Calles, the ex-Jefe Máximo of Mexico, lands in an airport in San Antonio, Texas. And when he gets off the plane, he's kind of like a greenish color, because he can't believe that not only was he kicked out of Mexico, but I suspect among the reasons why he looked so ghastly is that he couldn't believe that he was still alive.
Fui obligado a abandonar mi país por procedimientos violentos e ilegales, sin causa justificada alguna.
Cárdenas aggressively pursues agrarian reform. He structures the process so that both the peasantry and the country as a whole will prosper. 50 million acres of land are returned to the peasants. Labor reforms are initiated that improve conditions in the mines and factories and give the workers power they never had. Next, Cárdenas turns his attention to the issue of oil.
The petroleum workers come together and they form a powerful national industrial union. They put forward a demand for a new ambitious labor contract, which the private companies absolutely refuse to take seriously. They claim they can't afford to meet any of the demands of the petroleum workers.
Well, if we do that, we might just as well go out of business.
Most American and British oil company executives assume that a compromise deal will be reached between the foreign oil companies and the Mexican government.
But they fundamentally miscalculate. They miscalculate the determination of President Cárdenas, and a decision is made to expropriate the oil industry, which really sets the cat amongst the pigeons.
The oil companies thought that he would not dare to do so for several reasons. The United States would probably take strong reprisals against Mexico. After all, nationalizing oil, the strategic resource, was a tremendous challenge to the United States. Secondly, it was a precedent for the rest of Latin America.
Es decir, tenía una visión, una integridad personal, una valentía. Porque cuando se enfrenta a Estados Unidos no sabe muy bien qué va a pasar.
La expropiación petrolera no es simplemente de justicia, es de soberanía nacional.
Because the oil companies refuse to accept Cárdenas' terms, the Mexican government takes over ownership of the oil fields and pays off the oil companies. In the wake of the Great Depression, Cárdenas has saddled Mexico with more debt, but the Mexicans don't seem to mind and pitch in to help the government.
The news of the oil expropriation was greeted with jubilation by quite a large body of people. And in villages and in towns and in Mexico City, workers and citizens wanted to demonstrate their commitment and support to the government by ransacking the jewel boxes and ransacking the treasures to bring jewelry for donation to the state. It demonstrates how strongly the themes of economic nationalism and political pride had become by the late 1930s.
Thank you.
Despite the hostility aroused abroad by his wholesale expropriation, Lázaro Cárdenas remains the man of his people, determined to make Mexico the first completely socialized nation in the Western world, a Mexico belonging only to Mexicans. Time marches on.
By the late 1930s, Europe is once again on the brink of a world war. Fascism is taking hold in Germany, in Italy, and in Spain.
Nazi Germany was rising in Europe. The danger of a world war was increasing. In Latin America, especially in the Southern Cone, a lot of governments sympathized with the Nazis. Mexico could be counted on, unlike other Latin American countries, to profoundly oppose the Nazis.
In 1936, Hitler's power grows. In Spain, General Francisco Franco's fascist regime wages war to gain control of the government.
The Cárdenas government was profoundly anti-Nazi. It hated the Nazis, all the more so since Cárdenas identified himself with the Spanish Republicans, supported them in the war against Franco, where Germany and Italy were supporting Franco.
Mexico's official policy is to reach out and welcome refugees from these conflicts. Most other countries, including the U.S., do not.
Entonces México abrió las puertas a todos los que pudieran llegar a México en aquel momento. Llegaron 30,000 exiliados en los años fines de los 30. También se abrió México a muchos perseguidos por el nazismo en Alemania, en Austria, en Hungría. Llegaron, como digo, húngaros, llegaron judíos de muchas partes del mundo a asilarse a México.
We lived in Berlin in 1933. My father was a newspaper man writing articles against Hitler. We had to flee to France. My father was very active on the side of the Spanish Republic, so we had to leave France. We went to the United States on a visitor's visa, could not work there. And I think largely because of my father's activities for the Spanish Republic, we were given asylum in Mexico. And for us who had lived in constant fear of being expelled, Cárdenas' attitude meant that for the first time, we were completely secure. No one would expel us, no one would kick us out. So personally, I'm eternally grateful to the Cárdenas administration and to Mexico for having saved our lives.
In the 20 years following the revolution, Mexico begins to find a sense of unity and reconciliation. A new Mexican identity will arise from the turmoil and struggle of the revolution.
A principios de los años 20 se empieza a dar en México una verdadera revolución cultural. Ha terminado la revolución armada, pero ha dejado una estela de fuerzas y ha desencadenado una serie de energías que los intelectuales de la época van a asimilar.
Beginning in 1921 with the establishment of the Secretariat of Public Education, the federal government implements a vast social and cultural program involving education, literature, and the arts.
Thank you.
Bueno, sí, evidentemente los artistas están viviendo una nueva realidad. Un movimiento social, un movimiento revolucionario, no se queda meramente en el pincel y no se queda meramente en la tela. O sea, va más allá. Entonces, van a tratar de ver también una realidad diferente. Y entonces también los temas van a estar hablando de un nuevo concepto mexicanista, o sea, un nacionalismo diferente. Es siempre este buscar nuestras raíces, buscar nuestros orígenes.
This search for a new Mexican identity is reflected in the creation of public art. In the past, art was seen in the rarefied atmosphere of museums, available to only a few. Now, vast murals in public places can be seen by anyone walking by.
Diego Rivera, José Clemente Orozco, Siqueiros, Silvestre Revueltas, y otros, ¿verdad?, van a empezar a pintar murales en donde se reconstruye la historia de México. Se rescata a los personajes populares de la Revolución. Y por primera vez tenemos un movimiento pictórico centrado precisamente en el paisaje y en la vida cotidiana del pueblo de México, tanto del campo como de la ciudad. Estos muros también tienen un propósito didáctico, porque en esta época un alto porcentaje de la población de México no sabe leer y escribir. Y por lo tanto, su acceso, ¿verdad?, a la realidad mexicana es mucho más accesible si se hace a través de la pintura.
La gente, los mexicanos, al verse retratados en los murales, empezaron como a creer en sí mismos, a sentirse reconocidos. No porque todos los campesinos de México vinieran a ver los murales, pero sí porque sentían que había hacia ellos un respeto que no habían sentido antes, ¿verdad? Y eso yo creo que los alentó, los hizo crecer.
Entonces se produce este renacimiento cultural que se expresa principalmente en la pintura, que es uno de los movimientos más conocidos, pero también en la literatura, a través de lo que se ha llamado la literatura de la Revolución Mexicana. La literatura de la Revolución Mexicana tiene muchas representaciones de los personajes populares de la Revolución, que luego van a pasar en muchos casos al cine mexicano.
One of the leading characters depicted in these movies is Pancho Villa, sometimes as hero, but more often as a villain. One of the most unique voices that emerges from this period is that of a young woman, a writer.
Nelly Campobello, yo la considero un alma gemela de Pancho Villa. Un alma gemela, o sea, son gemelos, ella mujer, el hombre. Nelly Campobello nace en la misma zona geográfica de Villa, en Durango, en el norte de Durango.
Nelly Campobello es la única autora de la Revolución Mexicana, la única novelista que hizo dos libros muy importantes, Cartuchos y Las manos de mamá. Ella en Las manos de mamá cuenta cómo ella misma como niña veía los cadáveres. Un cadáver que se quedó afuera de su ventana y cómo ella se encariñó con ese cadáver, hablaba con ese cadáver y se entristeció muchísimo el día que se lo llevaron. Habla de una infancia atroz, ¿no? Y también de su gran devoción por Pancho Villa. Ella fue villista toda su vida.
In her novel Cartucho, Campobello writes movingly about the soldaderas who fought alongside Villa. But Nelly, along with her half-sister Gloria, lives a whole other artistic life as well.
Las hermanas Campobello, Nelly y Gloria Campobello, se dedicaron a recoger todas las danzas populares, las danzas llamadas autóctonas del país México. Y eso fue una aportación muy única de gente, además, después de la Revolución, que creía en la Revolución y que quería cambiar la suerte de los mexicanos que tienen menos recursos. Entonces recogía sus tradiciones, sus cantos, sus costumbres.
Se van a buscar todos los sones prehispánicos y todo lo que quedó de las reminiscencias desde lo prehispánico y lo colonial y lo traen hacia la capital para hacer ballets que tengan al mismo tiempo que la parte clásica, la parte nacionalista, ¿no?
The explosion of the arts and the widely seen images of artifacts from Mexico's exotic past make the country a magnet for intellectuals everywhere. Inspired by Mexico's epic history, in 1930, Russian director Sergei Eisenstein shoots his tribute, Que Viva México.
Lo que es muy claro es la relación de Eisenstein, ¿no? Cuando viene a México, él lo dice muy claramente que él se influye mucho de los murales de Orozco, ¿no? Y de Siqueiros. Eso también se influye de los murales de Diego, de los murales de la Secretaría de Educación Pública. Entonces aquí está esta parte también del cine y la plástica muy, muy vinculada.
The flourishing of the arts in Mexico continues into the 40s. But in the political arena, the momentum of the revolution comes to a halt when Lázaro Cárdenas leaves office in 1940.
Cárdenas sincerely believed that he could create institutions that would remain progressive in their policies and in their vision. But what happened after he left office was that the men who followed him took Mexico back to the right and used those institutions and all of that legitimacy and political capital that Cárdenas had generated to turn those institutions against the very people that they were allegedly supposed to help. And that would create the political long history of the dominant party that became known as the PRI party, the PRI.
The PRI, The Partido Revolucionario Institucional becomes a successor of the PNR party created by Calles in 1928. The PRI will dominate Mexico for the next 50 years with little challenge or competition. From the 1940s to the 60s, Mexico projects an image of prosperity, industrialization, and stability. But as PRI presidents continued to unravel the gains made by the revolution and ignore the promises of the 1917 Constitution, it seems almost as if the tiger will once again escape from his cage. And in 1968, he does.
México había sido escogido para que aquí se hicieran, en nuestro país, los Juegos Olímpicos en octubre de 1968. Yo no estaba dedicado a construir estadios, construir edificios, construir instalaciones deportivas para los deportistas. Y los estudiantes empezaron a decir que se estaba gastando muchísimo dinero, un dineral, en una fachada y escondiendo el México real, el México de la miseria, el México de los presos políticos.
Yo me fui a estudiar a los 16 años cumplidos a México, al Politécnico, y cuando estaba en tercer año se inició el movimiento estudiantil de 1968.
As preparations for the 1968 Olympics escalate, Mexican President Díaz Ordaz enforces a little-used law to silence and imprison students and political dissidents.
Hicieron marchas que nunca se pensó que en México se podrían dar, marchas de 300,000 personas en el Paseo de la Reforma. Pedían una liberación en México, sentían que México era un país muy desigual, muy disparejo. Pedían la liberación de los presos políticos, pedían que se acabara el cuerpo de granaderos, que eran unos como gorilas con un casco hasta aquí y una macana que se dedicaban a pegar en las manifestaciones.
Sentir como estudiante en carne propia una injusticia muy grande que se había cometido durante los días últimos del mes de julio, pues yo me incorporé de lleno, como muchos otros estudiantes como yo, provincianos, y el movimiento deja de ser estudiantil. Ya lo que nos estaba moviendo era el habernos dado cuenta de qué tantas injusticias estaba viviendo este país y cómo estaban viviendo los campesinos y cómo estaban viviendo los obreros, porque ellos mismos nos lo estaban informando y expresando.
Lo que fue muy grave fue la toma de Ciudad Universitaria. Entonces sí, las cosas se agudizaron.
On October 2nd, 1968, just 10 days before the Olympics are set to begin, thousands of workers and students peacefully demonstrate at the Plaza of Tlatelolco, a housing project in the center of Mexico City. Without warning, the army and police fire on the mass of unarmed civilians.
Recuerdo que a las 5 de la mañana, entre una y otra, fui y vi como un paisaje de guerra, un paisaje después de la batalla, con de veras las paredes llenas de sangre, zapatos de mujer y zapatos de hombre regados en todas partes. Se veían balazos en las paredes, muchísimos vidrios rotos. Entonces era una verdadera toma militar de la Plaza de las Tres Culturas.
Over 300 people are killed.
Como soy periodista, empecé a entrevistar a la gente, a recoger testimonios. Toda la gente que llegó a los hospitales presentaba heridas en la espalda, en los brazos, en las piernas, en los glúteos, pero nunca de frente. Entonces, fue, yo creo que para todos nosotros, un golpe tremendo enterarnos de esa matanza.
En la historia no hay muerte, en la historia hay continuidad. Y hay escalones, hay cambio, hay evolución. Entonces, lo que surge en 1968 no es un problema entre estudiantes y el gobierno, es un problema muy íntimo en la historia de este país, de una inconformidad que nos toca a los jóvenes en aquel momento. Los movimientos en Estados Unidos de los años 60, los movimientos en Europa, se pasaron a hacer historia, ¿no? Pero México no es historia, es parte de la vida.
General Emiliano Zapata, fue mi abuelo, gracias a Dios. Los ideales de mi abuelo que él nos dejó plasmados en el Plan de Ayala no se han cumplido tal como él hubiera deseado. Tal parece que su lucha fue infructuosa. Y una vez yo le pregunté a mi padre que por qué no teníamos tierra. Y mi padre me contestó, dice, porque, dice, mi padre no luchó nada más para nosotros, dice. Él luchó para todo el pueblo en general. La idea de mi abuelo, como él lo dice en su frase tan célebre, la tierra es de quien la trabaja con sus propias manos.
For those of us who have family who work the fields in places like Michoacán, Jalisco, Zacatecas, the Bajío region, Morelos, you can name all of those states in which people to this day continue to work that land. For them, the land is a means of organizing their lives socially and culturally, not only economically. And we have to understand how a lot of those people are forced to migrate, are forced to leave their lands, are forced to leave their way of life, to incredible poverty and in those shacks that surround Mexico City, that surround Los Angeles and San Antonio. It resonates with anyone who cares about how and why so many of Mexico's rural people continue to this day to overcome that struggle for life that Emiliano Zapata represented, that Emiliano Zapata died for.
Si se celebra la revolución, pareciera como que estamos celebrando el status quo, las condiciones de miseria en la que viven los campesinos y en la que viven los obreros y en la que vivimos los mexicanos. Y si somos los herederos de esa revolución, pues no hay nada que celebrar. Ahora, si pensamos en la revolución como esa explosión de energía creativa, creo que sí habría que celebrarlo, porque fue una propuesta de una nación más justa, menos desigual, más honesta, es decir, con una identidad de la cual nos podíamos sentir orgullosos.
For more information about the storm that swept Mexico, please visit PBS at pbs.org. Major funding for this program was provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Funding for this program has been provided by the National Endowment for the Humanities, because democracy demands wisdom.
Additional funding was provided by the San Francisco Foundation.
Be more. PBS.